Kubernetes was created to run applications at scale. So in this video, let's talk about autoscaling. Now, there are many different controllers, some of them built-in and some that you need to additionally install in your cluster. For example, your online store may get a lot of traffic during the day and almost no one using it at night. So in order to save on compute, you can either manually adjust or have some kind of cron job to scale up your application during the peak hours and scale it down at night to avoid wasting resources. It's much easier to do it if you have stateless applications than scaling up and down some kind of distributed databases. Another example would be a big data ETL pipeline where you periodically, let's say every hour, run a batch job that takes maybe 10 minutes and you don't want to pay for the remaining 50 minutes of compute when you're not running anything. For example, to scale up your application to handle more traffic, you increase the number of pods. Now, those pods run on Kubernetes nodes. A node can be a VM or a server in a data center. If you don't have enough nodes in your Kubernetes cluster, you need to scale the cluster itself as well. So in this video, we'll talk about how to autoscale pods on one hand and Kubernetes nodes on another. The most common approach that comes to mind when you need to autoscale your application to handle increasing load is to use horizontal pod autoscaler based on CPU or memory. It automatically updates the replica count on your deployment or stateful set object. Horizontal pod autoscaler is implemented as Kubernetes API resource and a controller. The controller runs within the Kubernetes control plane. So there is no need to install anything extra in this case. It periodically adjusts the desired scale of its target, such as a deployment object based on metrics like CPU, memory, or custom metrics, which we'll discuss later. Now, the controller ships with Kubernetes, but you still need to provide metrics for it to work. Again, the most common approach would be to deploy the metrics server in your cluster. Some managed Kubernetes services, such as GKE, comes with a metrics server by default, while for others, such as EKS, you would need to install it as additional step. To follow along, you can use Minikube, and you can find the source code in my GitHub repository. The easiest way to verify that the metrics server is deployed is to run kubectl top pods. If you get the error metrics API not available, you need to install it, and I'll show you how. You can use Helm CLI to deploy it manually, or my preferred approach would be to use Terraform with Helm provider. Now, when you deploy the metrics server in your cluster, it will scrape the kubelet of each node and provide those aggregated metrics to other components in your Kubernetes cluster via the metrics API. To verify, you can use kubectl top pods command to get the usage. Another way is to run kubeproxy and then in your browser go to APIs metrics namespaces to get the usage. And you can also obtain the same metrics using kubectl get row command. Now you can start using horizontal pod autoscaler resource. Let's say we want to target this deployment object with my app. Keep in mind that for the autoscaler to work, you must provide resource requests. Limits are optional but highly recommended. The HPA uses requests, not limits, to calculate usage in percentage. For example, in this case, we want to automatically scale pods if the average CPU utilization across all the pods exceeds 80%. You can also include memory usage. Here we want to scale if the average exceeds 70%. Let me quickly run the demo with all these objects deployed. When you apply, it may take a few seconds for the HPA to show the current usage. If it takes longer, you can describe the HPA object to find any errors. Most likely, this happens when you forget to define requests for your pods. If we simulate high CPU usage, it will spin up enough pods to reduce the average CPU usage below 80%. Now, when the load decreases, it may take a minute or so for the HPA to scale down the pods. The last thing that I want to mention is that you should not set the replica count on the deployment or stateful set object if you use GitOps approach. In that case, the HPA and your tool such as ArgoCD or FlagCD will constantly fight to set the desired replica count based on their spec. Now, autoscaling based on CPU or memory is not very accurate, because different applications may have different requirements. One application may be fine running at 90% CPU usage, while another may only handle 40% CPU usage. The best way to scale your app is to use more meaningful metrics from the client's perspective. A good starting point is four golden signals: latency, traffic, errors, and saturation. For example, if you ran some tests and determined that a single instance of your application can only handle 100 requests per second. Unfortunately, we can't use a metric server for that. We need something more powerful, such as Prometheus. In order to use custom metrics for the horizontal pod autoscaler, we need to deploy a few things in our cluster. First of all, we need a Prometheus operator that will manage the lifecycle of Prometheus instances, as well as convert service and pod monitors to the native Prometheus configuration. Then we'll deploy Prometheus instance itself using custom resource provided by the operator. Let's say we also have the app running in Kubernetes that we want to monitor. We'll create a service or pod monitor to scrape that app and store metrics in Prometheus itself. The next step is to provide those metrics to the horizontal pod autoscaler. For that, we need to deploy a Prometheus adapter that will convert Prometheus metrics and register them at the custom metrics API. From that point, we can use custom Prometheus metrics exposed by our application in the autoscaling policy like this. Now, in the previous part, we discussed that to autoscale based on CPU and memory, we need to deploy a metrics server. Since we already have Prometheus, we can get rid of metrics server altogether and use CA Advisor to get CPU and memory usage from the pods and register Prometheus adapter with the metrics API. If you want to fully replace the metrics server, you would also want to deploy a node exporter on each node to get node metrics. So if you configured everything correctly, you should be able to scale your application based on custom metrics such as number of requests per second or any other metrics. Now, sometimes you have stateful applications that are very difficult or impossible to scale horizontally. For example, a standalone database such as Postgres or MySQL. The only option you have to handle more load is to scale those applications vertically. This simply means adding more CPU or memory to the existing pods. Kubernetes has a tool called Vertical Pod Autoscaler that can help you with that. It has a few mods. There is a recreate mode, which should be used rarely because VPA will try to evict and create a new pod with new recommended resources, which can be very dangerous for the standalone databases. Another mode is initial, which only sets requests and limits when you deploy the application. And finally, which I use most often, is to simply get recommendations and not take any actions. The vertical pod autoscaler also consists of a custom resource and a controller, but it does not ship with Kubernetes, and you need to install it additionally in your cluster. Using this mode, you can describe or get the VPA in your cluster, see recommendations, and perhaps apply those requests and limits during the next maintenance window. Keep in mind that you should never use HPA and VPA simultaneously targeting the same deployment or stateful set object. They will conflict with each other and may disrupt your workloads. Also, I don't see a point in getting recommendations from the VPA for the stateless applications that can be scaled horizontally. For example, if you run 5 web servers, you get recommendations specific to the current load that 5 servers can handle. If you run 20 of the same web servers and try to get VPA recommendations, they will be very different. So don't use VPA for stateless applications, even in recommendation mode, and only use it for the stateful apps that cannot be scaled horizontally. There are a lot of companies nowadays using event sourcing. Some companies completely rely on some sort of messaging system to communicate between different microservices. It can be Apache Kafka, RabbitMQ, NATS, and many others. On one side, you have a bunch of producers that write to the messaging system, and on the other, you have consumers. This pattern allows you to decouple your services and simplify the development of new features. There is a Keda project that can help you to autoscale based on the number of messages in the queue or a topic. For example, Keda can monitor RabbitMQ queue and scale your application if the queue keeps getting more messages and your service is not able to handle the current load. One advantage of this approach is that it can scale your application to zero if there are no messages in the queue. There are many different scalers supported, and you can find them on the official website. It includes cloud services such as DynamoDB, as well as open source projects such as Apache Kafka, etcd, MySQL, and many others. To start using Keda, you need to deploy the controller using a single Helm chart. It does not have any other dependencies. After that, you can configure a custom resource to automatically scale your application. In this case, we will assign 5 messages from the queue for each replica. Now, if you deploy it, you can apply the Kubernetes job to start publishing messages to the queue. And in a few seconds, Keda will scale up your application from 0 to maximum you defined in the custom resource. After your application processes all the messages, Keda will scale your application down to 0. It's optional, but you can keep a few instances running if you want. So far, we've talked about how to autoscale applications or pods running in your Kubernetes cluster. The next major topic is how to autoscale the Kubernetes nodes. Let's start with a cluster autoscaler. It was one of the first projects that automated Kubernetes node autoscaling. In some clouds, such as AWS, you need to explicitly configure permissions and deploy your own cluster autoscaler controller. Others, such as Azure and GCP, allows you to simply check a box and cloud will deploy and manage it for you. In most clouds, Kubernetes node groups are created as autoscaling groups. Some allow you to specify multiple instance types within a single group, while others only permit to use a single instance type. After you deploy the autoscaler, it will watch for pending pods in your cluster. If it detects a pending pod that cannot fit into existing nodes, the autoscaler will increase the desired size of your autoscaling group, and the cloud will spin up additional nodes for your cluster. The problem with that approach is if you use large instance types and a single tiny pod does not fit into existing nodes, the cluster autoscaler will create another node with the same CPU and memory as all other nodes. In many cases, this can lead to wasted resources, and you would pay more than you actually use. To fix this issue, AWS developed another tool called Karpenter. It works with other clouds as well, not only AWS. Instead of simply scaling up your node group with the same instance types, Karpenter will analyze the pending pods and create EC2 instances directly with enough CPU and memory to fit the pending workloads. In general, this approach is more efficient than scaling up node groups. However, there are some edge cases when you run logging, monitoring, and other agents as daemon sets, and generally want to use large instance types to minimize the number of agents you have to run on each node. And finally, you can use serverless Kubernetes clusters provided by AWS, such as Fargate, and by GCP, which they call Autopilot. When you create a pod, Kubernetes will spin up a dedicated node for it. In this case, you don't have to manage your nodes yourself and worry about wasted resources. However, these serverless clusters are much more expensive in terms of how much you pay for CPU and memory compared to EC2. So you might want to test it before committing to the serverless approach. But it does reduce the maintenance of your infrastructure. That's all for this video. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.